Okay, so welcome everyone. Lots of familiar names and people that we've seen earlier. So welcome for to another webinar of Get Set Up. As most of you who know, who've been regulars, and for those who've joined probably for the first time, Get Set Up is on a mission to help those over 55 years to learn new skills, connect with peers, and unlock new life experiences. Our goal is to reduce isolation, loneliness, and just assist everyone to age well in place, to allow the community to give them the tools and knowledge to age independently. Our community engages in classes online as well as activities offline, like traveling across over a number of days as well as day trips. What we've been doing at Get Set Up has been very valuable to a lot of people of our community. So anybody who's still waiting to join in, please download the app and enjoy the Get Set Up's platform. Today is an interesting topic, and a topic which a lot of you all have asked in the past in some of these sessions that we've had. So we bring to you gold versus mutual fund as an interesting topic. The topic has been brought to you in partnership with Franklin Templeton, one of our partners. Franklin Templeton, as some of you all know, are the largest asset managers in the world, managing close to $1.4 billion. They've been around for 75 years. In India itself, they've been around for 27 years plus, and have been managing in India roughly close to 78,000 crores. Franklin Templeton itself offers a bouquet of funds across debt, equity, hybrid, international, and you name it. They've been advising as well as allocating for many of our community members as well. They're keen to disseminate information on various opportunities of how retired or retirement stages can be managed by asset allocation across various asset classes. The topic today is very relevant, especially in the days of volatility. And as we dive deeper into it, we'll talk more about it with Mr. Sridharan. Mr. Sridharan, welcome. He's been a regular Get Set Up, and somebody who needs no introduction to all the regulars. But for anybody who's never heard him before, Mr. Sridharan is a prolific writer and speaker, especially on retirement planning. He's the recipient of Associate Financial Planner. He has been contributing to many magazines and newspapers on personal finance, for example, moneycontrol.com, Financial Express, Times of India, etc. He's got 15 years of experience as an independent financial advisor. And he conducts many sessions, especially on retirement planning, across major public sector institutions and banks. Example, Bank of India, Indian Bank, Canara Bank, etc. Welcome, Mr. Sridharan.
Yeah, good evening. Good evening, Ashwini.
Good evening and greetings of the day to whosoever's who've joined in from India and elsewhere. Sir, an interesting topic for all of us. We've been historically, and actually as a nation, we've been a huge consumer of gold. As generations have gone by, we've always learned as kids from our parents, from our parents' parents, and so on and so forth, that gold is one of the safest and the best way to invest or to save money. We all know the historical relevance of it, mostly as a good saving opportunity, especially in the age and day when many instruments weren't available. Also, in the current environment, as a very strong hedge against inflation, but I'm sure it has its own side effects and its own cons as well. Especially notice that last week the government of India decided to increase the import duty on gold. So I'm sure we are consuming far more than the government is comfortable with. That we as a nation should be consuming. That it impacts the macroeconomic as well. So I'd like to hear from you that what's the joy of gold that we all love to hold it as an investment or love to go after it. It has its own gratification moments, of course, as jewelry and forms that we all use it. But if you could just throw some historical perspective on gold, and we'll be keen to hear from you your perspective.
Yeah. Thanks. So primarily, you know, gold is considered to be a kind of an asset. So there is no doubt about it. And it shines and, you know, historically talking, you know, the men holds houses, women hold jewelries. they hold gold. So that's the way, actually, you know, the as you rightly said, you know, our parents and forefathers and, you know, the grandfathers and forefathers thought that way, because, you know, the physical assets, see, basically, you know, financial assets are in the play only in the last, you know, probably 50, 60 years or so. Prior to that, you know, the primary assets that are considered to be land and gold, none other than land and gold are considered to be an asset class. So in the modern world, you know, these asset classes are primarily taking a backseat because, you know, to some extent, it is illiquid in nature. And also, the modern world, you know, people are not living in one particular society or one particular place. So they keep traveling around, and, you know, might be you might be sitting in India, your children might be settling down in other part of the country. Earlier, actually, you know, we were shifting between within the country itself. Now the entire world is basically, you know, is the workplace available for every individual. So it's all the after the you know, primarily the global economy that was opened in 90. So the places that people can travel around for work related or anything, you know, that is actually, you know, has become a very huge you know, movement that has happened. So from that perspective, you know, the gold ornaments, of course, you know, gold is an asset class. There is no two things about it. Gold is an asset class. There is no doubt about it. But only from the investment perspective, gold ornaments are not considered as an investment very precisely, because ornaments are basically used for consumption purpose. So when we use it for consumption purpose, we can buy gold jewelries. So the jewelries, from the perspective of jewelry, yes, you know, the cost of acquisition is very high, because, you know, when you buy gold, there are two things. One is the purity. Second is the cost that is involved in acquiring gold ornaments. So maybe, you know, your wastages and other things will probably take away 20% of the overall cost. So from that perspective, you know, we recommend there are alternatives against gold. So why gold is what something that we need to discuss, because, you know, see, we are the second largest importer of gold across the world. So we are the second largest importer of gold, that too for the ornamental purpose. Gold as an ornamental purpose, we are actually, you know, we are consuming second largest, you know, jewelry across the world. That is the reason why, you know, we keep importing gold and uses ornaments. And as you rightly said, because of curtailing the import, they are increasing the import duty. So that is another reason why, you know, the gold prices in India, especially the ornamental prices, are keep increasing in India because of the import price. And when we are talking about gold, see, gold is a hedge against inflation. It just, you know, probably provide you a return, whatever the inflation is basically being adjusted. When the inflation is high, you get a higher return. When the inflation is low, you get a lower return. And apart from that, so gold is the only, you know, the commodity that can be converted into any currencies. So that is another key advantage of gold, is being purchased by every individual. You know, everybody considered that as an asset class. And then when we are talking about the gold price movement, so the gold price movement is basically, you know, it moves opposite direction to the economy. So when there is uncertainty in the economy, the gold prices tend to move up drastically. When there is, you know, during the global financial crisis, or during the, you know, the taper tantrum, or maybe during the, you know, the Twin Tower attack, or during the Russia-Ukraine crisis, or even during the COVID period. So these are the events that you can probably, you know, mark it down, and then you can probably go cross-check. These are the period where the gold prices have gone up significantly higher. The reason is, whenever there is any uncertainty, people tend to go with the the safety and security of investment is basically gold, because you know they can carry gold and then they can move on to other country and then they can survive. That is the reason why this is considered as the safest haven.
It's so funny, and as both of us are kind of have a little smile on our faces, the topic is so interesting. We have got questions coming in the chat room, so just to let everybody know that we'll take questions at the end. Keep them pouring in the chat. Yes, it's an interesting topic. We all are lovers of gold. We all know it. It reminds us of the movies in the 70s when Warsaw Beach where gold used to come down. So it is so emotional to all of us that we are all enjoying. But more importantly, I think as Get Setup's thesis goes about creating environment for everybody to be more knowledgeable and empowered. Topics like these come up forward from within the community. So please feel free to let us know if you're open to kind of being approached by us to get to know about interesting topics that you like to talk about, you like to write about. We can feature you. Your teachings can help the rest of the community, and because of whatever you experienced in your investment strategies or your learnings, we can share it with the larger community. So let us know if you're interested. Just drop a yes in the chat, and we'll take it from there. Mr. Sridhar, an interesting part about the part that it's a great hedge instrument or a hedge investment. It's a preserver of value. We all historically have loved it for it stores value. It's a dependable store of value. If you just look at historically some data, it's that, you know, over a 3 year or even a 15 year horizon, gold's always been managed to beat inflation. Now, if an average inflation rate, if you take a 7%, now it's average. We all know that there's lots of other context to it, but something that we'll hang our hats on 7%. It's always beaten over a 3 year period. I think I have data which says it's about 8.28%. Over a 5 year, it's gone up to 13%. And back again, if we look at a 15-year horizon, it's close to about 11%. Are you saying that because of volatility and economic cycles are volatile, and situations like the crises, wars, or other situations like the financial crisis that happened in 2008, gold becomes an asset class that people and the governments love to hold and store, and because of which prices go up, and that's what gives you an average of like 10-15%? What would you read that into, and what are the options to kind of hedge against inflation?
As a hedge against inflation, gold is one the investment avenue that we are talking about. Again, you know, the gold prices, you know, every 8 years or 10 years, economy recycling is happening. You know, the economy will go for a boost, and then it actually, you know, burst at some point in time. So that threshold limit is basically, you know, that is basically a cycle of 8 to 10 years. So during, when there is a big crisis happening, the gold price actually suddenly jumps up by 50% or 40% during, let us say, during the COVID year, 2020, the gold price went up by 40%. Similarly, during the global financial crisis, you know, in 2008, the gold price went up by 50% in a single year. So after that, it stabilizes once the economy comes to a recovery. And it just stagnate for some time. And then, you know, again, it will probably, you know, go in line with the inflation. So that's the way, you know, it basically, you know, provides a kind of a return. See, when we are talking about the other alternates available instead of gold ornaments, you know, that is the biggest, you know, the question that I even, you know, I could see in the chat box also. So basically, you know, when we are talking about the other alternates, so basically gold coins and biscuits, see, if they are really wanted to have a touch and feel experience, so people actually, you know, they wanted to see, touch and feel. So that is the experience that everybody wants. So if they want a kind of, you know, touch and feel experience, see, touch, feel, so then probably they can go for a gold biscuits or gold coins. So that is the option available, because, you know, the purity of these gold coins and biscuits are 99.9%, and that is universally acceptable. So you can just carry gold, and then you can travel around wherever you are. Actually, you can sell the gold and then get the currency of whatever the country that you are traveling to. And second option is actually, there are gold ETFs that are available. The paper gold is basically gold ETF. So this is, again, you can have a demat account, and then you can buy, sell, and you can also do a kind of a trade in demat account. You can buy and sell at any point in time. It only, takes about 2 days of liquidity. See, assuming, the only problem with the physical gold is the storage. So you need to find out the place where you can keep the gold. And then there is a problem once again.
Sure, no problem at all. Well, while you come back, back to you, sir.
Pardon?
Back to you.
Yeah. So from that perspective, holding it, and then, you need to pay for the locker and all those stuff. So instead, you can buy gold ETF. Gold ETF is where you can buy 99.9% purity gold in the paper format, and you can buy and sell any point in time. There is no question of, illiquid. You can sell at any point in time, and then if you want to buy gold ornaments or something, you can save using gold ETF. That's one thing that is available. And the other option is basically, the sovereign gold bonds that is basically being announced by the government of India. And the key advantage here is basically, the government will be providing 2.5% interest on the investment that you are making. And along with the 2.5% interest, you will be getting the incremental value on gold price. Basically, if you buy gold at 5,000 rupees today per gram, after 8 years, because it has got an 8 years lock-in period, after 8 years, the gold has probably, come to, let us say, 6,000 rupees. You will be getting 6,000 rupees per gram or the redemption, or, when you are redeeming the bonds, you will be getting at that point, whatever the value is there. So you'll be getting it. So the gold price also, is the additional return that you're getting. On top of it, the government also paying you 2.5%. Only disadvantage with gold sovereign bond is basically there is a lock-in period of 8 years. That is the only this one. So though, the liquidity is available after some point in time, but still, the buyer should be available when you are trying to sell. Because if you buy it in the DMAT form, it can be tradable. But again, when you sell it, somebody needs to be there to buy. So from that perspective, 8 years lock-in period, if you are buying, if you wanted to accumulate gold for your daughter's marriage or something else, then this could be something, which one can look at. And then final option is basically, the gold savings mutual fund also is available. So gold savings mutual funds, these also, invest in gold ETF. So it all tracks the gold prices only.
So it's interesting that you mentioned. So you're saying gold is a fair amount of it's a reasonably good asset to invest in for its all its pluses, but within that it should be physical gold or paper gold, as in representing the gold as the underlying, so that at least you get the benefits of the price movement in gold over a period of time, and that is why it hedges inflation. But stay away from gold jewelry. Now that's going to be controversial in at least definitely my house. So
every house. It is not in your house.
I guess everybody's house.
If my wife listens to this conversation, I cannot go back home and have my food tonight.
I'm sure I heard that from my mother, from wife, everyone. So it's effectively what we're saying is that there is people, we as a nation have been tempted. Rightly so, because that was the only option to hedge against inflation. But we've been going towards the jewelry. Unfortunately, the opportunities earlier weren't available, like the gold ETFs or the paper gold or the Government of India bonds. or even physical gold was not easily available, because now banks keep it in banks. You can buy from your nearest bank branch, were not so easily available. Jewelry has impurities. Jewelry has making and buying making charges. So hence your gain that you may have on inflation kind of gets negated by any kind of leakage, for example, or loss of value because of the making charges going in between. So that's not an asset, that's consumption gold. So we need to understand consumption versus asset for investments, asset as even heirloom to be forwarded to the next generation, or whatever the case may be. We take assets.
Yes.
Interesting. Let me switch then. If historically it's kind of only barely given, inflation rate 8-10, and in an earlier session with you, and here again I'll point out to our audience and members who have joined in, that feel free to just pop in if other topics of interest that you may like to hear in the future, and learn from it as well. Be open to the idea to be reached out by us to feature you or any of your written articles about some of these classes that you have been experiencing and get set up. Switching back to the inflation part of it, 8 or 10% of return over a long period of time, with its illiquidity as one of the part, illiquidity in nature as one of its features, lock-in period in the government bonds as another feature or detriment. How would you want to, you advise a lot of people on retirement, how would you like to kind of advise that, what should be the extent to which I should or I may want to look at gold? And then what is the balance if there is not 100% of my savings going into gold? And how should I look at inflation as being that big animal out there or that's something that eats into everybody's savings, if you want to maintain a decent enough lifestyle post our active work life?
Okay. So since it is actually, beating the inflation, it doesn't mean that, the entire 100% of your savings has to be invested in gold. So gold as an asset class, you should not get exposed more than 10 to 15% of your overall investments. Let us say, if you have 100 rupees, out of which we would say not more than 10% to 15% in gold as an asset class. And the rest should be invested in equity. Equity is one of the, we were talking about, gold versus mutual funds. When we are talking about mutual funds, even the same period of time, we are talking about a 3-year or a 5-year, 10-year period. I have just taken the data of just a Nifty 50 and Nifty 100. I'm not even going beyond Nifty 100 because, there could be some kind of a risk that is associated with the mid and small cap. And when we are talking about the Nifty 50 and Nifty 100, these are all well-established companies, stabilized companies where you will get a kind of a stable return. So on a 3-year period, the Nifty 50 has delivered about 15% return. And on a 5-year period, also, the same thing, 15%. See, this Nifty 50 is delivering about 15% consistent return on a 3, 5, 10 and 15 year period. So when on the other side, the gold on the longer period, since it is a hedge against inflation, that could deliver only 7-8% return. On an average, you could get about 8% return over a long period of time. Because, as I told you, suddenly the price jumps up and then, there could be a kind of a time correction that could happen to gold. So normally, price correction or time correction has to happen to any asset. So in the case of gold, the price will suddenly jumps up and then stays for a longer period, so that the time correction is something, that could happen to the gold. And then the price will again start moving in. That is the reason why if you look at on a 10-year basis, or a 15-year basis, the gold has actually delivered about 10% or 8 to 10% return is what actually one can expect. So from that perspective, the equity-based mutual funds will always deliver a superior return than your inflation. It provides, 4 or 5% alpha against your inflation. So from that perspective, it doesn't mean that, the retirement money, you should not invest in equity, because the post-retired life is extended because of the medical sciences. So we will be living, you know, even somebody is retiring, let's say about 60, they may live up till 90 or 95. Now, even century is not a bigger deal nowadays. So because of the medical science improvement and the quality of life also has been improved compared to the previous, the century. So from that perspective, when we are going to live for the next, 20 years, 30 years post-retirement, if you are not exposed towards equity, then probably, you know, the money that you have accumulated might be depleting after some point in time, you know, which may not be sufficient for you to have a better inflation adjusted return on your investments. So from that perspective, you know, the gold is, of course, you know, 10-15% can be invested in gold. And then, you know, it depends on, individual risk appetite, one can go up to 50% exposure towards equity-based mutual funds. And then balance can be there in the debt funds. So in the fixed income, they basically, you know, there could be senior citizen schemes or your post office schemes or your corporate fixed deposits. These are the avenues that they can probably diversify their investments. From the overall perspective, yes, of course, you know, 40 to 50% they can have in equity-based mutual funds and 10-15% in gold and then rest in fixed income instruments. So that is the allocation one can follow to ensure that they get a, you know, kind of instead of getting about 12%, 15% return, at least, you know, they will be getting about 10 to 11% return. So that would probably, you know, beat the inflation over a longer period of time.
Nice you say that. It's interesting in a way you say that is that since you've been kind of, you specializing in retirement planning. So you're saying that even post-retirement active work life, equity should form some part of your exposure. And especially if not, most of us are not directly into equities for various reasons. Mutual fund, equity via mutual fund is a good option. And still you're saying that 50% should be there. 10% in gold, so that's a good amount of, or maximum 10% in gold, so that's about 60 taken away, so about balance about 40 or is it 50% of the 90? But broadly equities cannot be ignored is what you're saying in bottom line, right?
True, very true.
And that's because over growth period, and especially again, we've seen that historically in the last 30 years as well, and it's not going to go away soon. Is that the compounding effect of equities is anything between 13 to 17% if depending on what when you enter and what time you started and how long you remain invested, but over 10 plus years of compounding, it's easily in double digits, whereas gold barely about covers inflation. So that fact is established.
Yes, that's true.
That fact is established. Okay, interesting. So I think so far what we've realized, and we'll throw open to questions and see lots of them. So maybe just ask Tina or some, Tina, if you could just kind of pick up a few from there and while in a minute or so, I'll come to you and put together, in the chat and summarize, you know, all similar topics of questions together. But in summary, so far, gold in its purest form or paper, so again, closer to purest form, paper is, as long as you don't want to physically see it and touch it. So yes. Gold in its purest form is the only one which hedges you to an extent on inflation. So it's an asset class to be considered. Second is that consumption gold therefore definitely is not to be included in that. And your total gold investment, so to say, of your savings or your retirement corpus is should be capped at close to about 10-odd%. And the rest can be split across equity and other fixed income like FDs or senior citizen service savings or even fixed income mutual funds. That's more about each one's risk appetite as well as, you know, individual planning that people may do, you know, sitting with you and your team. So that's kind of established. I think we are kind of clear now that it's an asset class that should be or that may form part of your investment, not emotionally attached to it. Jewelry, definitely not considered investment, and purest form. And mutual funds should form part of your portfolio, the equity portfolio, definitely, since we all don't get chance and time to track individual equities. If you have, that's great. But I think it's the mutual fund, at least I do that as well, and many of us do that. And the fixed income can be across the asset allocation, across all of these. So let's go into some of the questions, sir. There is actually backward
up. Well, summarized.
Please elaborate what you mean by time correction in price of gold. I think that's an interesting thing that you mentioned between. It crossed my mind as well. So could you just elaborate on that?
Yeah. So assuming, you know, you buy gold today, okay, let's say it is 5,000 rupees per gram. Okay. And suddenly, you know, there is some, you know, the war or some, you know, economic crisis happening. So suddenly what happens is this 5,000 rupees gold price will jump up to, let's say about 30% jump. Let's say, you know, it has jumped to 6,500. Assuming the inflation is 10% every year, it was supposed to grow 10% on a year-on-year basis, correct? But suddenly, because of the global crisis, some crisis, it has jumped up by 30% or 40%, let us say, within a year. So the gold price from 5,000, it went up to 7,000. So this 7,000 was supposed to happen 4 years later, not now. Correct. So what happens is, you know, the 7,000 rupees after, you know, the crisis gets over, what happens is, you know, the 7,000 might be coming down to 6,700 or something. But that stays for 6,700 for 1 or 2 years. Because the price will not suddenly correct back to 5,000 rupees. So the gold prices will not fall, you know, to the extent of how it is jumped up. It is not like equity.
So it jumps in spurts.
Yes.
Jumps in spurts. When there's stability, it remains stable. When there is exuberance or crisis on either side, it jumps.
Just jump up. Jump up and crisis. Stays for a long period of time. That is what we and call it as time correction. But price correction and time correction, that could happen to equity. Either right. Way.
And somebody's commented on the fact that the asset does not give regular income over here, but it makes up for its appreciation as capital appreciation for the loss of interest. So that's a fair point somebody just made. Good question. Another question over here: gold ETF. Do we have to pay any transaction costs like STT, etc.? And what is better, ETF versus gold MF? And while you address that. Immediately after that, you can probably address, you can go ahead with that. I'll come to you with another question. Yeah.
Yeah. So the STT, security transaction tax, and the brokerage expenses, that is something that one has to pay. See, compared to paying GST of 3% when you buy gold, the biscuit.
Good point. Yeah. Yeah.
So compared to 3% GST that we are paying on buying gold, even the gold coins, you know, this might be, you know, not more than 0.2-0.3% is the expenses that you may be incurring when you are buying and selling. Buying 0.3, selling 0.3, it is not more than 1% of your overall cost, basically. So this is the cheapest acquisition plan compared to gold, physical gold also.
Yeah, another quick, I think this is more a fundamental question. You mentioned about Nifty 50, etc. So Nifty 50 and Nifty 100, what are those? These are benchmarks of the exchange, of the stock exchange, which take the top 50 or top 100 companies, and there's a formula behind that. But basically that benchmark is what you can use to kind of just see what's happening to the market. They represent the market itself. So that's how we all kind of look at returns against the Nifty 50 or Nifty 100. Mr. Sridharan, is it fair to kind of...
Yeah, what you said is rightly, you know, this is right actually. See, basically, you know, every stock market has its own benchmark. So when we are talking about top 50 companies, what proposition they should be there in the, you know, the stock exchange. So that is what is being, you know, given in the Nifty 50 or any stock exchange, even BSE, Sensex 30. These are all called as bellwether stocks, which kind of, you know, giving you a sense of where the stock markets are moving towards. If it is positive, the entire stock market will be positive. If it is negative, the stock market will be, you know, going in the negative direction. So to give an indicational, you know, sense of where the markets are moving, so this Nifty 50 and Nifty 100, these are the benchmarks that has been set by the stock exchanges.
Right. Some interesting comments have come in the past, which is basically talking about, you know, there are people known to accumulate physical gold. So they've been doing exactly what you've suggested, that even if you want to do it as an asset class, do it in the purest form, which is coins or biscuits or the paper form. Can you please detail on government holding gold, which they were able to pledge during the 90s? Now, that holding of physical gold is not being entertained by government and the demand from the present younger generation is also coming down. Can we expect a downward trend in the decades to come? Rather, rate of return will be lesser than 7 or 8% as of now. A very interesting question. This is the point that you made about in crisis, gold becomes the only form which is universally accepted. There are and no questions asked. That even as a nation, when we were in crisis in 1991, and we remember that time where we had only less than 2 weeks of reserves for paying for our imports, we pledged the country's gold and borrowed. So at an individual level, again, that's how the philosophy of holding gold becomes that at during crisis, that forms the only universally accepted you know, asset class. Do you think that going forward, now you've said that 10% can be in gold, do you see going forward its value or interest in because the younger generation is not even bothering about jewelry so is it that there is a chance of its value getting eroded and not even covering 7-8% which so far we have seen? A view that you can probably share, you know, discussing.
You know, sound an interesting question. See, to be very precise, there is no gold ore available in the country. So there is no gold mining, you know, that is happening in India. We always have to import. And we are the second largest importer of, you know, gold across many years. Maybe, you know, one or two position up or down, that could happen. But we are the second largest importer of gold. And to be very precise, you know, whatever we talk, actually, you know, the women will not agree because the men are from Mars, women are from Venus. So they always believe in jewelry, and whether one form or the other form, they buy and then keep it in the locker. There is no, they cannot wear 50 sovereigns of gold and walk. That is the pride that they have. And definitely, you know, whatsoever we are talking, there could be some kind of, you know, 10%, 15% change that could happen. Not beyond that level. So that is one. Second is, when we are talking about the availability of gold as an asset class, so that is still there. See, because, you know, see, the currency is only, you know, the gold. See, earlier, actually, you know, the entire import exports were measured only in terms of gold. That was changed only in 1970 or so. That time only, you know, the US made this one statement that, you know, it has to be measured in terms of dollar. So again, the trend might be, you know, in my view, might be reversing to gold rather than currency. That is the reason why, you know, if you look at, you know, all the countries are coming out with the cryptocurrencies and their own, you know, the universal acceptancy level, they wanted to change. See, this is something where it will change dynamically once in 100 years, once in 50 years. So that will keep changing. From that perspective, in my opinion, gold is something, you know, which may not change. because you know that is the only commodity, physical commodity available for everyone to exchange for asset, other assets, basically other commodity rather. So from that perspective, it will still provide you about because you know the inflation, we cannot say the inflation will go down. Rather, you know, earlier actually, you know, the inflation was only about food inflation. Now lifestyle inflation is being added. So when we are talking about, you know, how many of you are not having mobile phone now, the biggest question, but same question when I asked 20 years back, that was actually, you know, considered to be a kind of a luxury commodity. It has become essential commodity. Because of that, actually, you know, every 3 years, 5 years, we keep changing mobiles. That is inflation that is being added. So from that perspective, as long as we produce products, then there is no question of, you know, inflation and GDP. GDP and inflation will coexist. And since it is coexisting, gold also existing the, you know, in the system. That is what my view.
No, interesting. You said that it will never lose its status as an asset class because you know, gold standard moved from the gold standard was disbanded, and currencies came in play, and for trade and commodities, it basically became the US dollar. Lesson in economics history in that, but importantly, what also you said that as long as there are economies and there's growth happening, there will be inflation, there'll be some value attached. So what one can do is keep adjusting. And this is what we took up in another session in on the webinar, is that you need to evaluate your portfolio regularly. So if today you are at 10% gold, when the trailing return is probably not as good, you can, in that year, you kind of switch by making adjustments in your portfolio. So I think what you're suggesting is that it can be a part of the asset class. Keep a watch on it. It does you know, take care of a fair bit of inflation, and it's an universally accepted asset class on its own. But to take care of your lifestyle inflation, you didn't touch upon something another which is also zooming very high is medical inflation.
Yes, very true.
Lifestyle one can still kind of keep it on the side and
compromise,
and, yeah, and compromise. But medical is just stares at all of us, you know, strangely enough. So that's a topic for another discussion, another point of time. There's a question about the probability and possibility that can there be capital lost in SGB? I'm assuming SGB is sovereign gold bonds. So is there any probability and possibility that we meet with capital loss in us SGB?
See, since it is an 8 year period, so whatever the tranches that has come in the past, so it's all actually have given a positive return. See, basically, as I told you, the return might be negative for some period of time. It might be for 6 months or 8 months or 1 year, not more than that. So even in the past, you know, during the Russia-Ukraine crisis, you know, when they declared a war, immediately on the same next 2 days, the gold price went up by 10% or 12% within 2 days. But once the war continues and there was no major, you know, the effect on the war, suddenly the prices have come back to, you know, basically, you know, that 12% upside that has happened, it has come back to the basically to the normal price. So once, if somebody buys during the peak of the, you know, the crisis, maybe, you know, they may be losing about 5-10% in the short period of time. So that kind of a price correction that keeps happening on gold. But only thing is, you know, what we are looking at is when you have a gold in your hand, you won't find the value every day because, you know, you need to go to a jewelry shop to, you know, find out the real value. But when it is coming to ETF and sovereign gold bond, the prices are actually, you know, visible. Since it is visible, you are actually, you know, checking on a daily basis. And then, you know, see, I'll give you a simple example. You know, you won't do, you know, you don't take ECG on a daily basis to check your health. Similarly, you know, this is something where, you know, the gold price and then the mutual fund price, which are available on the screen, on the mobile, people are tend to, you know, check on a daily basis. If they avoid that, the short-term correction, you know, is negligible over a long period of time. This becomes the big hole now, but maybe after 6 months, 1 year later, if you see, it automatically, you know, corrects its value.
But you're right, and capital loss is something which is in every asset class. The possibility of a capital loss is always there. So
yes,
it's a matter of, you know, how you kind of how long you stay in it, what is your own risk appetite, and how you kind of manage your cycle of investments for, because if it's not capital loss, it's definitely inflation loss. For example, I keep having this discussion with my father about FD versus and
that's well, a real session we need to have.
So a topic, another conversation, so we can put it on the topic bank for another time. But that's, you know, whether it's capital loss or inflationary loss, it's always there. But to be fair, historically, over a longer period of time, it does give you a positive return. So effectively, you shouldn't see a capital loss. But yeah, adjusted against inflation, you could still it may not get 8%, but it, you know, less or more depending on where inflation is at that point of time. So one needs to not ignore that inflation. And interesting, another question which was there, I missed out on that, and you keep referring to it as gold ETF. Is there a difference between a gold ETF and a gold mutual fund? Because mutual funds do come up with schemes which underlying non-equity. They're talking about multi-asset. They're talking about underlying being gold. So how what are the difference? What are the subtle differences?
Gold saving schemes, they purely invest only in gold ETF. The underlying asset is only ETF. And there are multi-asset funds, which are actually, you know, come in the last couple of years. It has been introduced in the last couple of years. Most of the fundos are coming out with multi-asset fund. We don't basically, you know, agree on multi-asset in one single fund. So mixing up asset classes in one single fund is something, you know, which we don't agree, because the correlation between equity and gold is completely reverse. So when the economy does well, equity does well and gold doesn't do well. When the economy doesn't do well, your equity does not do well, but gold does well. So one would be, you know, not a complement of each other. So basically, you know, if both the assets goes in tandem, then probably yes, you know, you can have a multi-asset, multi-asset fund. But here actually, you know, we will not really see the real growth of, you know, the gold and equity. See, a simple example, both equity and gold, only during 2020, suddenly, you know, the equity market doesn't do well, gold price went up, and then after, let's say, about 6 months later, equity also started doing well. So this is one of the rarest scenarios. It doesn't mean that, you know, always, you know, gold and equity keeps doing well over a long period of time. So from that perspective, it is better to have a separate investment in equity as a separate investments, gold as a separate investment, so that, you know, you get a real sense of, you know, what you are investing on. Because you may not be able to understand whether gold has delivered a return or an equity has delivered a return if you are combined the investments in multi-asset funds.
So in the bundled option, you may not be able to get the real or true understanding of which is giving you return. Whereas if
exactly.
You segregate it, you will be able to track it and manage your portfolio in a more efficient manner.
Exactly.
Got it.
That's what.
Got it. I think somebody's question about shares versus mutual funds. We are going to have a few of these sessions across about basic understanding. So you may want to log in into that also in the future. But just as a summary, maybe Mr. Sridharan, you can take it briefly. But there's a separate session going to happen about what are mutual funds and how are they different from shares in general. So please do watch out for that class or that webinar as well. But Mr. Sridharan, what's the subtle or basic difference between
difference between stocks and mutual fund is one key aspect of mutual fund is diversification. So as far as the direct stocks are concerned, you know, the diversification is missing in stocks. And again, here, there is a professional who is going to manage the investments. So they are also investing in stocks only. End of the day, you know, the underlying investments are into stocks only. But here, there is a professional who manages. Whereas here, understanding the company, understanding their balance sheet, and then, you know, understanding the industry where they are in, whether the industry does well, all these researchers, as an individual, it is very difficult to do all this research and then invest in the direct stocks. That is the disadvantage that one has in selection of stocks. Whereas here, the mutual funds, even see, basically the minimum amount that you can invest in mutual fund is only 10,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees, let us say. Within this 5,000 rupees, you can also have a fraction of, top companies, you know, is something that you can buy. But if you buy, let us say, one stock of Nestle, that's the biggest company. So the one stock of Nestle itself is about 14,000 rupees. So one cannot have that kind of a money, or maybe, you know, that kind of a research that they can do it, can probably do the same thing with the mutual funds. That is the difference. But in depth, we can have a separate session, as Ashwini said.
Yeah, I think that's another reminder to everyone. We keep posting regular content for our learners on our website, on our blogs, and various formats that you can engage with at Get Set Up, including please download the app, and there you can get a lot of content across financial well-being, health well-being, everything that matters to the community. And we are the largest peer-to-peer platform in the country to get everybody connected and learn from each other. So a lot of similar content. And you can also put your feedback over there. If there's something that you haven't found over there, you'd like to learn about it, we can keep curating some of this content for you all to kind of both, again, learn and enjoy and exchange views from each other. I saw a last question, and I think we're just about nearing time. Is waiting for the next session. Thanks for a lively session. Okay, so that was not a question, that was a comment. So we kind of have come to the end of the session, Mr. Sridhar. We've given back to our audience roughly 4 minutes back to them. So once again, thank you very much. I'll just summarize what you just said. An asset to look out for is gold in its purest form. It is an hedge against inflation, but it's not the best hedge against inflation. So don't keep everything over there. Keep managing the gold asset to about close to about 10-odd%. The rest of it should be in some part should definitely be in equity. Equity mutual funds being one of the easiest way, because they're managed by professionals who keep track of markets and its movements on their own. And another 50% of that can be in fixed income, which is again whether it's FDs or senior citizen deposits, or even bond funds or mutual funds, depending on tax treatment and tax and liquidity that people are looking out for. So that's in summary the learnings from our interaction with Mr. Sridharan. Once again, Get Set Up is a peer-to-peer platform, creating learning and engaging content for our community. So please do not forget to join us and let the community learn from you and engage and socialize with your peers. Mr. Sridharan is available on our classes and our webinars. So please feel free to attend. Watch out for the next class out there at Get Set Up. And our partners, Franklin Templeton, one of the largest fund houses in the world and one of the longest one present in India. So thank you very much to them as well. So with that, Mr. Sridharan and everyone, good night and greetings.
Yeah, thank you.